गुड मॉर्निंग। प्लीज वेरीफाई द पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन विजिबल ऑन योर स्क्रीन एंड सेकेंडली यू कैन हेयर माई वॉइस क्लियरली सो दैट वी कैन कंटिन्यू।
यस सर।
डू यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन? जस्ट फील कंफर्टेबल एंड आस्क इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम माई प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स एंड देन वी विल गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू। If you have some issues with the mic or you do not want to speak on mic, in that case you can write your questions in the meeting section. Meeting chat. Just feel comfortable and ask if you have any questions. This is the last call from my side. Do you have any question from my previous lecture? So what we were discussing in our last lecture, we just started the anatomy by Stalitica. So as I told you, as far as the parasites are concerned, and we were discussing the protozoan parasites. So the classification we follow is the organelle which they use for locomotion. So we classified them. Some of them they were using the cilia, some of them they were using flagella, some of them they were amoeba, and then we have a phylum, we name it as the Epicomplexa, where they do not have any specific locomotory organs. But as I told you that when it comes to the understanding of the protozoan diseases, we just classify them according to the site of infection. So either they are the intestinal protozoan parasites or they invade your tissues or blood. So we started discussing the intestinal protozoan parasite. I told you that there is a flagellate that causes an infection in the intestine. We name it as the Giardia lamblia. It uses the flagella. There is a protozoan parasite that is amoeba and it causes infection in the intestine. We name it as the Entamoeba histolytica. There is a ciliate that uses the cilia and it is causing an infection in the intestine, and we name that Bullantidium coli. And then we have the Cryptosporidium and Isospora. They are from Epicomplex and they are also causing intestinal infection. When it comes to the major intestinal protozoan parasite, the most common one is the Entamoeba histolytica. Why it's significant? Because if you look here, it causes approximately 55,000 deaths each year. Why it is significant? Because it has worldwide distribution. Why we put that parasite when we were discussing the protozoan parasite of your intestine at the top? Because this parasite is more common. It has something to do with hygienic condition, and it's more common in underdeveloped and developing countries rather than countries where people have more hygienic condition. Principal host, always human. But dogs, cats, rodents, they can be infected. And the last statement, in the entire course, I will not going to mean it's not possible. There is no commercially available vaccine against any of the parasite. Although we have commercially available vaccine against viruses and certain bacteria, but as far as the parasites are concerned, there is no commercially available vaccine, and we'll go into discuss later on that why we failed to develop vaccine against the parasites. As far as the morphology of Entamoeba histolytica is concerned, I told you the Entamoeba histolytica exists in two forms, One are the trophozoites, the main feeding form of the parasite, that is about 15 to 30 micrometer in diameter. And then they have another morphological form, we name it as the cyst. Cyst is normally spherical. And it's much, much more smaller in size as compared to the trophozoites. The purpose of cyst is to withstand the harsh climatic conditions. Because in order to successfully transmit an infection from one person to another person, Entamoeba estelitica must require to come outside the host into the environment, and then it is required to contaminate food, it is required to contaminate either water, and then through contaminated food and water, it is required to be ingested by another person for a successful transmission of an infection. Although there is no intermediate host involved, that's why we use the term that it has a direct life cycle. But still, the cyst, they come into the environment. And as it comes to the environment, there are fluctuations there. So environment is always harsh, it resists. So what will going to happen is that in order to withstand those harsh climatic conditions, the morphological form that is present outside the body of host in the environment, we name it as the cyst. Much smaller, more spherical. And normally the mature cyst is quadranucleate. What do I mean by this? That mature cyst of Entamoeba estelitica has 4 nuclei. And once, as it comes out of the person, normally the immature cyst, it has only 1 nuclei. And in the environment, these nuclei, they will divide. The nucleus divide into the 4 nuclei. The initial division is always from 1 to 2 and then from 2 to 4. That is all mitosis. There is no meiosis going on there. There is no sexual reproduction in Entamoeba estelitica. So what happens? That once a person ingests a mature quadranucleate cyst, they are about 10 to 15 micrometer long, sometimes even less than that, 7 to 10 micrometer long. So they are microscopic. They are not visible with naked eye. Very, very small. So through contaminated food, through contaminated vegetable, water, what will going to happen? That a person ingest this quadranucleate cyst. As they are cyst, so there eventually, once they got ingested, they reaches to the stomach, and in the stomach there are acids and enzymes. But those acids, what is going to happen? That the cyst resists the acids of stomach, and eventually this cyst reaches to the small intestine. In the small intestine, there are enzymes that are going to degrade the cyst. And eventually, these 4 nuclei, the cytoplasm will going to divide. And these 4 nuclei, they will develop into the 4 independent trophozoites. And from the small intestine, they eventually migrate to the large intestine. And there they will going to invade the epithelium. That's why Entamoeba estelitica is an invasive species. It do not just attach to the surface of epithelium, rather it causes destruction of the epithelium and it enters into the epithelium of large intestine. And there it undergoes the division and it multiplies there, increases in number, and some of those trophozoites eventually they become cysts and they will be released along with the feces. And once they are released along with the feces, what will going to happen? That they will go to the environment. There, in the environment, the cyst, they will go in going to mature and they will going to divide their nuclei and eventually contaminate food or water, and then they will look for another possible transmission. So the main active feeding form of parasite is trophozoite, much larger than the cyst form. And as I told you that it's a trophozoite is a general term that refers to the active form. And that's the life cycle. That normally it's a fecal oral route. That infected person shed the parasite through feces, and a normal person ingest the parasite along with food or water. So fecal or oral route. So it's a direct transmission. And if you look here, let me use my pointer. So what happens? That when mature cyst, they got ingested, from the ingested, they eventually reaches to the stomach, and from the stomach, it reaches to the small intestine, and then eventually it reaches to the large intestine. And once it reaches to the large intestine, what will going to happen, that this will going to invade it, and then eventually they will divide, they will increase in number, and some of those parasites, eventually they will going to develop a cyst around them, and they will going to release along with the feces. And once they got released along with the feces, so the cyst nuclei, they will divide, and eventually they, in the environment, they will become quadranucleate cyst, and those cysts, they are once again infective to other persons. As I am discussing the first life cycle, the two very important things you need to know. A lot of people, they will ask you about the infective stage. And another important thing in the life cycle is the diagnostic stage. As far as the infective stage are concerned, I mean, we use the infective stage on which, in which stage the parasite manages to enter into the body of host. That is referred as infective stage. And if you look here, they have mentioned the infective stage. So the infective stage, at which stage the parasite manages to enter into the body and cause infection. So what we take in, when we ingest the parasite, we ingest the quadranucleate cyst. So the mature quadranucleate cyst are the infective stages of the parasite. And the second important thing is the diagnostic stage. Normally, we diagnose amoebiasis by identifying the cyst or the trophozoites in the feces. So sometimes the trophozoites, they are shed in the feces, and sometimes the cysts themselves, they are shed in the feces. So if the trophozoites, they shed into the feces, they will going to develop a cyst around it. Sometimes even in the large intestine, they will develop a cyst around them, and then they got released in the feces. So as far as the diagnostic stages is concerned, both the trophozoites as well as cysts, we look under the microscope. We, in order to diagnose an entomy by Seldriga, what we need to do, that we take fecal sample, because if someone is infected, the person must be shedding the parasites in the feces, either the cyst form or the trophozoites. So in order to diagnose entomy by Seldriga, we take fecal sample of suspected person, and then we observe the parasite under the microscope in the feces of infected person. So if we manages to see that parasite, either the trophozoites or the cyst, that confirm our diagnosis. So the diagnostic stage is trophozoites and the cyst both. But as far as the infective stage is concerned, is a mature quadranucleate cyst. The immature cyst and the trophozoites, they fail to cause a new infection, because both immature cyst as well as the trophozoites, they got destroyed by the acids of your stomach. That concludes my discussion on life cycle of endomastyle. As far as the valence, sorry, mobile game. So as far as the symptom of amoebiasis is concerned, there are two stages of infection. One is the acute phase and other one is the chronic phase. Can anyone differentiate what is an acute phase of a disease and what is a chronic phase of a disease? Just feel you, make yourself feel comfortable and try to answer this question. This is just about the diseases. It can be any infection. It is not restricted to only parasites. So acute and the chronic are the general terms. So what is acute? You have 30 seconds to respond. Any volunteer? Just feel comfortable. What is acute? Normally, it has to do with the diseases. And these are the phases of diseases. Acute. Yes, please. Someone unmuted the mic. Just feel comfortable and answer. Please, do you want to answer? I do not know who is that person, but. So acute phase is normally of a very short duration. So it's short duration. But how we define an acute phase is that when the sign and the symptoms of a disease is very, very severe. So for a short duration, and when you have very, very much severe sign and symptoms of disease. So, severe signs. I'm just learning how to write using the cursor, so I have just severe signs. While chronic phase is defined by a larger duration, but you have moderate signs and symptoms of a disease. Maybe you have seen people that who are experiencing some chronic diseases. So what happens that in those cases, they are not very, very sick, but they are not well. Neither they are very, very sick, nor they are well. And you can call them as a normal healthy person. Rather, they have signs and symptoms of a disease. They are not feeling well, but the severity is not very, very. So normally the chronic stage, it can last for years. And Sorry, I lost my internet connection. Can you hear my voice properly? Please confirm so that I can continue.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Was there distortion in the previous section of this lecture as well? You can hear my voice.
No, sir.
Everything was okay? Okay.
Yes.
I just suddenly lost my connection. I do not know why, but okay. So we're going. Do you have any question?
No, sir.
Okay. So when you have diarrhea with blood and mucus, it's all dysentery. And dysentery that is being followed by an abdominal pain. Second, moderate fever. So when a person visits a hospital and someone has showing some signs and symptoms of a disease, it's always important to carry out a diagnosis and on the basis of signs and symptoms, the physician, they will going to suspect a disease and then carry out the diagnosis. So as far as the dysentery and abdominal pain is concerned, we also have dysentery and abdominal pain in case of bacterial infection as well. One way to differentially diagnose, either it's a dysentery of bacterial origin or it's a dysentery of amoeba caused by a parasite that we name it as the Entamoeba histolytica, is to look for the fever. In case of bacterial infection, there is always a high fever. But in case of amoebiasis, either you have moderate fever or you do not have any fever. So that's a very critical point. And then another form is the chronic phase of the disease, when the signs and symptoms, they are not severe, the dysentery is not severe, and you do not have a very severe abdominal pain. So in case of chronic disease, you have recurrent episodes of dysentery with blood and mucus in the feces. And there is a continuous gastrointestinal disturbance. Sometimes you will have the constipation, at another time you will have the dysentery. So in case of chronic disease, you spend few days very well, and then eventually you have some experience, some constipation, you see some abdominal cramps or abdominal pain, and that is being followed by the dysentery that includes the blood and mucus, and then you recover from those, and then you have another episode. That's how it works in case of chronic diseases. So two forms, mainly two forms. One is the acute phase of amoebiasis, and another one is the chronic.
Excuse me, sir.
Okay.
This slide is showy.
Okay. Is it visible to anyone else?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If it is visible to some students, in that case, I have shared the slide. Okay, let me share it again. Please verify. Is it visible to your screen now? Okay.
Yes,
everything is okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So that's the intestinal amoebiasis. And that this is the major form of the disease which we see in majority of the cases. But in some instances where people, they are experiencing the chronic amoebiasis, the amoeba may leave the intestine, because as it is an invasive species, so it invades your epithelium. What do I mean by the invasion? I will going to show you in the next slide. If this is your epithelium, in that case, amoeba will going to disintegrate the epithelium and enters here. So as it is an invasive species, so what happens that in case of chronic disease, it's not true for every chronic case, but it's possible that when someone is chronic for amoebiasis, the amoeba may eventually enters into the intestine, and from here it starts invading and make its way to the either to the liver, lung, and brain. So when amoeba invades liver, lung, and brain, that is not real true site of infestation. We name it as the extra intestinal amoebiasis. But that occurs rarely. It's not with every chronic case. And in the lung, liver, and brain, what it causes? Abscesses. Lung abscesses, liver abscesses. Abscesses is nothing else that where the amoeba is staying, it will go to disintegrate the tissue, and eventually, once the tissue got disintegrated, you have an immune response and all that, because you will have the pus and fluid and all that kind of stuff there. So amoeba with plus pus, fluid, and all those disintegrated tissue, so eventually we name it as the abscess. So that's the extra intestinal, when the parasite leaves its original site and moves to some other places. When it comes to the pathology, amoeba causes intestinal ulcers. As it invades the intestine, so it causes ulcers. And those ulcers, they are mostly of flask shape. Ulcer is nothing else but a degradation of a tissue, and amoeba releases those enzymes that will going to disintegrate the epithelium. And once the epithelium got disintegrated, amoeba makes its way into the epithelium and it forms ulcers. And those ulcers, they are normally flask shaped. And then at any time, when you will going to see a word, maybe we discuss in immunoalgiitis, that refers to the inflammation. It causes inflammation. Where it goes, it causes inflammation. And inflammation is always because of your immune response, and you know it very well. So this is flask. So that's your epithelium. And normally your epithelium is intact. Let me change the color. So normally your epithelium is intact. But when the amoeba reaches to the large intestine, it will going to release the enzyme. Once it releases the enzymes in a specific pocket, because it uses the pseudopodia. So once it makes a space like this, here it will going to release all those enzymes, and those enzymes, they will going to disintegrate that area, and eventually the amoeba will going to make its way into the epithelium. And then it will keep on, that's why you see the blood and mucus, because once the epithelium got destroyed, eventually next to it there is a connective tissue layer, and you all know that your connective tissue layer has a rich supply of blood vessels. And epithelium is avascular, do not have any blood vessels. So once it disintegrates the epithelium, it reaches to the connective tissue. Once it reaches to the connective tissue, it will going to destroy the connective tissue. And during the destruction, the blood vessels, they also destroy. And once the blood vessels, they will going to break, you will have the release of blood into the lumen of the small intestine. Lumen refers to the cavity. And eventually, from that lumen, those blood spots, they will move out along with the feces. That's why you see blood and mucus in the feces. And these ulcers, they are roughly flask shaped. And at any time when you take some photographs and you see flask shaped ulcers, you always suspect flask shaped ulcers in the large intestine. You always suspect for entamoeba histolytica. Large intestine, flask-shaped ulcers, blood and mucus in dysentery, moderate fever. These are all huge clues that the person is suffering from amoebiasis. Another thing, diagnosis, when it comes to the diagnosis, diagnosis always based on symptoms, history, and epidemiology. But on the basis of signs and symptoms, you cannot decide, confirm the diagnosis of amoebiasis. They must be backed with a lab test. And the confirmation of the amoebiasis is carried out through the identification of the cyst in the feces or stools. And this is one thing why we already discussed, that you can distinguish it from bacterial dysentery by lack of fever. And secondly, PMN, polymorphonuclear leukocytes. Can anyone define what is polymorphonuclear leukocytes, cytosis? What is leukocytosis? When we were discussing the immunology, we discussed three terms: leukopenia, leukocytosis, and leukokemia. Do you remember that? I'm expecting that you remember nothing, because it was the third semester story. Any volunteer? And as I told you, that leukocytosis is a huge indication when we were discussing the immunology. Leukocytosis refers to the increased number of white blood cells as compared to their normal. But here, a specific kind of white blood cell number got increased. And that white blood cell appears to be multinucleated. That's why polymorphonuclear. Do you remember that? They are granulocytes. With multi-lobe nucleus. Initially, people thought that they have multiple nuclei, but later on they realized that, okay, they have a single nucleus, but that nucleus is multi-lobed. Do you have any clue regarding this? They are neutrophils. So in case of bacterial amoebiasis, you do not see any increase in number of the neutrophils. While in case of bacillary dysentery, you see increased number of neutrophils, because neutrophils, they are protective against the bacterial and the fungal infections. They are the most dominating type of white blood cells in your blood. So as they are not effective against amoeba, so you do not see any increase in number of the neutrophils. Do you have any question regarding this? Transmission occurs through fecal oral route. So either it's through contaminated hands, contaminated food, contaminated water, anything contaminated, and that must required to take the route of take or oral route. So it must require to be ingested. And those quadranucleates, they are required to be ingested. Risk factors, poor hygienic conditions, contaminated food and water, contaminated hands and utensils. And then you have people, they consider it as sexually transmitted pathogen. As far as immune system is concerned, we have comprehensive discussion on immunology in our last course. So as it is an extracellular parasite, it do not invade any cell. Although it invades the epithelium, but it's not an intracellular parasite. It's an extracellular parasite. So we see an antibody response against the parasite. Drug of choice, iodoquinol, asymptomatic, and when someone becomes symptomatic, we name it as the metronidazole or flagyl. And that treats both acute phase, chronic phase, also extra-intestinal disease. So that concludes my discussion on amoebiasis. Do you have any question regarding this? Just feel comfortable and ask. So now I will going to switch to another intestinal protozoan parasite.
Sir.
जी.
सर आपने बोला था जो ट्रोपोजोइट होता है.
Yeah.
जो एक्टिव फॉर्म में होता है. फिर आपने बोला कि ये कोई इन्फेक्शन काज नहीं करता. तो फिर ये एक्टिव फॉर्म से क्या मुराद है?
You accept my apologies. May I fail to communicate properly? I told you that trophozoites they fail to cause a new infection. Although in once the cyst reaches to the small intestine, all those nuclei, they will going to take a fraction of cytoplasm and plasma membrane along with them. So they become all trophozoites. And the entire infection is caused by the trophozoites. What I wanted to say that if the trophozoites comes out of the body of the host through feces and do not develop into the cyst, our trophozoites, they directly got ingested by another person before they could convert into a cyst form. As the trophozoites do not have a wall around them, so when they got ingested, they will be disintegrated by the acids of the stomach. Because in order to cause a new infection to a new person, as it takes the route of oral route, so what happens that from the mouth, it must need to go to the stomach. And from the stomach, it needs to go to the small intestine. In the small intestine, then it needs to go to the large intestine. That is the specific site of infection of Entamoeba stellitica. The cyst manages to escape the acids of stomach because it has enzyme, it has a wall around it. But if through contaminated hand, through anything, if the trophozoites they got ingested by a new person, the trophozoite cannot cause an infection because they will be disintegrated by the stomach. As far as the real infection is concerned, once the cyst converted into the trophozoites in the large intestine, the entire infection is caused by the trophozoites. It's not the cysts that are causing infection. What I wanted to say that a trophozoite cannot be transmitted from one person to another person. Because it involves that environment as well as during ingestion, it involves your stomach that contains acids. Is it clear now? Just feel comfortable.
Yes, sir, clear.
What I wanted to say that trophozoite cannot transmit the disease from one person to another person. But as far as the infection in large intestine is concerned, the entire infection is caused by the trophozoites. Because they are the feeding form, they are causing ulcers, they are dividing and they are multiplying and they are increasing number and they are disintegrating your intestine. So they are that's all activities carried out by trophozoites, not by cyst. The enzymes, they are being released by the trophozoites. So entire infection caused by a trophozoite. But trophozoites themselves cannot be successfully transmitted from one person to another person. In order to have a successful transmission, the trophozoite must require to convert it into the cyst form, and then the cyst is required to mature in the environment, and then eventually it is able to cause an infection to a new person. So accept my apologies if I fail to communicate that thing appropriately. Do you have any other question? Just feel comfortable and ask.
सर अगर जो ये सिस्ट है ये कोई और एनिमल भी तो इंजेस्ट कर सकता है ना, लेकिन ये पैरासाइट ह्यूमन के अलावा किसी और को इफेक्ट क्यों नहीं करता?
पैरासाइट्स दे आर नॉर्मली स्पेसिफिक फॉर द एज फार एज देयर होस्ट आर कंसर्नड. they do not survive in non-specific host. But as far as the Entamoeba histolytica is concerned, Entamoeba histolytica is not very, very host specific. What do I mean by it? That Entamoeba histolytica is not restricted to only human infections. Although majority of the cases, they are of human origin. And that's my slide which I was showing. Although in majority of the cases, the humans, they got infected. But dogs, cats, and rodents may also be infected by. So these are also the host. So Entamoeba histolytica takes options. It can take other animals as host as well. But other than these, if the Entamoeba histolytica goes to some another host, it will fail to cause an infection because parasites, they are specific to the specific host. Even they are specific with reference to their site of infection. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So inflammation kiski cause karega?
Inflammation in the large intestine. And you know why you got inflamed? Because in response to any infection, your immune system got activated. And you will have pus and all that come, irritation. So it causes inflammation in the large intestine, where it is destroying the intestinal tissues, inflamed. Because the intestinal tissue once got destroyed, you will have leakage of blood, and along with the blood, you have all those immune system got activated and it causes inflammation. And you know, heparin and the histamine, they are the real agents. So it will be large intestine, inflammation of the large intestine. Do you have any other question? Just feel comfortable and ask.
Sir, you have said that this species is specific.
Yeah.
So, sir, what is the thing that makes this species specific? Why can't these other species affect it?
Because they are adapted to survive in a specific environment. Although Entamoeba histolytica manages to use a range of hosts. So, if you look at the life cycle, they are tailor-made to survive against the acids of stomach of human, and then eventually they may reach to the small intestine, and in the small intestine, in response to those enzymes, they will going to degrade those cysts, and once the cysts got degraded, they make their way to the large intestine. Although Entamoeba histolytica is not very, very host specific, but in case of host specific, which are very, very specific, which do not infect any other species, in that case the parasite, what we claim, that initially they were free living and later on they adapted to the parasitic lifestyle. And during the adaptation, they have adapted themselves to those specific conditions which are specific in those specific hosts. If those conditions they got changed, either they will fail to survive, or maybe they will going to survive, but they will survive as an accidental host. And in that case, the host will be accidental and their life cycle cannot be completed. So that's a bad story for both parasite as well as for host. Because they have to continue their life cycle. And the host, they are fitted into their life cycle that ensures the successful transmission as well as the survival of the parasites. Although when it comes to the intestine, Entamoeba histolytica uses a range of locations, but just give yourself a little bit time. When it comes to the Plasmodium parasite, the sporozoids, they have specific receptors. And with the help of those receptors, they are able to invade the hepatocytes that are of human origin, liver cells. Do you think they will go into those sporozoids, they will going to find the same kind of receptors on any other species? No. And if they fail to find those receptors, even if mosquito injects and transmits those sporozoids to any other species, and if those hepatocytes are not there, the sporozoids, they will fail to get entry. And once they fail to get entry, they will fail to divide. And once they fail to divide, they fail to cause infection, and that's a dead end for the parasite. With Entamoeba histolytica, we are flexible because they can cause infection in dogs, they can cause infection in cats, they can cause infection in rodents as well. Because when it comes to the intestinal parasites, they are quite optional. they are not very, very selective in case of, they use a range. But if the, those conditions of the host, they got changed, they cannot survive. Because they have adapted themselves to those specific conditions. Is it clear? That's why we see host specificity, not only host specificity, but specificity to the site of infection, within the host, a specific site. Although certain parasites, they are not very, very much specific. So they use certain options. Gentlemen, do you have any other question? Is it clear? Just feel comfortable and ask. Is it clear?
सर जी जब पैरासाइट नहीं जाता कि वो अपने होस्ट को किल करे तो फिर इन्फेक्शन क्यों कॉज करता है उसमें
पैरासाइट ओनली वांट्स टू थिंग्स इट नीड्स फूड एंड शेल्टर प्लस इट नीड्स न्यूट्रिएंट्स वेयर इट कैन डिवाइड रैपिडली So what happens that when a parasite takes shelter, when a parasite takes food, so when it takes food and then when it will going to divide, this is all at the expense of host. So as it, this is all at the expense of the host, so definitely if the host is being destroyed, destroyed in case of Entamoeba basilica, it's an invasive species, so it must need to invade the tissue so that it can feed on everything. So once it invade, so parasite is not invading to destroy the host. It's invading for itself to get to all those nutrients, to get a space where it can live, to get a space where it can divide. So when it will feed, it will divide, it will going to utilize that space. So this will be all at the expense of the host. So eventually, the host do not have unlimited resources to repair or heal itself. So ultimately, that leads to the cause of infection. Infections are the consequences of the activities of the parasite. And those activities, they are not oriented to damage the host. Rather, those activities, they are necessary for the survival as well as for the successful reproduction and of the host, for the successful survival and reproduction of the parasite. So parasite doing this for their own purpose. And they do not care that what happens to the host because they have to do this. If they do not do this, they will going to be eliminated. If the Entamoeba basilica do not invade the large intestine, where it will live, where it will feed, where it will increase in number. But if Entamoeba basilica invade the large intestine, in that case, the normal functioning of the large intestine will be compromised.
Sorry, sir. Next class start ho gayi hai. Sir is wanting.
Okay. Is it clear?
Ji, sir.
Okay, we will going to continue from the same place in next lecture. Just make yourself feel comfortable. Is it clear? So, dismissed. Class is missed.
Yes.